Now we have a talk by Vishwajagati, and I'm just setting it up so that.
Hello all, I'm Vishwa and I'm here to talk about
We're just waiting for him to join us, and then we start. Hello, Vishwa. Welcome, and I'll just introduce you, and then you can start. I'll play the video. You can just say a few lines, and then I'll play the video. So our next talk is by Vishwajagati. He'll be speaking on unveiling nesting strategies, investigating visual concealment, and nest site selection in lapwings.
Thank you for the introduction. So my talk has been pre-recorded and I'll be here to respond to any questions after the talk. Hello all, I'm Vishwa and I'm here to talk about my study titled Unveiling Nesting Strategies, Investigating Visual Concealment and Nest Site Selection in Elevated Lapwings. So let me first introduce my model system to you all, a ground nesting bird, the elevated lapwing. It is an elegantly long-winged plover with brown plumage and distinct yellow wattles and yellow legs. It is endemic to the Indian subcontinent and can be commonly found across the entire region. They breed during the dry season, typically between March to May. And there are two observed types of nests, stone nests and grass nests. So stone nests are those constructed using pebble, stones or soil balls. And grass nests are those made of grass materials. So the clutch size of elevated lapwings is usually 3 to 4x, and they primarily feed on spiders and insects such as beetles, termites, grasshoppers, and crickets. Despite being a fascinating species, research on elevated lapwings is very limited. And let's now talk about the nest predation and defense adaptations in ground nesting birds. Nest predation has been widely hypothesized as a major contributing factor to the failure of reproductive success in ground nesting birds. The selection of nest site, optimal clutch size, egg characteristics, and breeding behavior have been demonstrated to be influenced by predation pressure, and ground nesting birds have developed several defensive adaptations against nest predation. A few such adaptations are beehole defense, where they actively guard their nests and engage in aggressive behaviors, and nest concealment through vegetative characteristics and behaviorally induced camouflage. Additionally, some species have evolved to use cryptic nest sites or exhibit cryptic egg characteristics, such as egg coloration or patterns that match the surrounding environment. And most of these adaptations are based on the visual concealment of the nests. So, for this study, we have focused on two major concealment strategies adopted by most ground nesting birds against nest predation: nest concealment through vegetative characteristics and concealment through egg camouflage. Our study had two primary objectives. First, to quantify the visual concealment strategies, nest concealment through vegetative characteristics and egg camouflage. Specifically, we investigated pattern complexity and disruptive effects. So, most studies in this field have primarily focused on the colors of eggs and background substrate rather than more intricate aspects such as egg surface patterns and background substrate textures. The amount and arrangement of maculation or markings on eggs, as well as the textures or the background substrate, are important factors that can affect egg camouflage and potentially affect egg survival. Here in the study, we have focused on the camouflage mechanisms, which are based on these patterns, and I'll be talking more about these camouflage mechanisms in the coming slides. So, and the second objective was to analyze the nest site choice in relation to the availability of food and vegetation cover. So nesting birds are expected to choose nest sites that maximize their reproductive success. In ground nesting species, nest site selection is commonly influenced by factors such as the risk of nest predation, nest substrate, vegetative characteristics, and availability of foraging substrates. Therefore, our Second objective was to analyze the nest site selection and elevator lapping, focusing on the factors food availability and vegetation cover, and also to investigate whether they actively select nest substrates to camouflage their eggs. So as I mentioned earlier, there are two types of nests observed in the species, stone nests and grass nests. So we conducted a comparative analysis of different nest types, stone and grass nests, to determine the camouflage mechanisms utilized. The study was carried out within the campus of the National Institute of Science Education and Research, India, and two distinct locations within the campus were selected for the study, the football ground and the cricket ground, which offer two different habitats for ground nesting birds. So the football ground is characterized by moderate vegetation cover and is subject to frequent human disturbance due to recreational activities, and additionally it has a relatively high population of feral ducks. High intensity artificial light sources are also used to illuminate this ground daily. Whereas in contrast, the cricket ground is an abandoned area with high vegetation cover, very little human disturbance and a small population of feral dogs, and no floodlights are present in this location. And the study areas, most common nest predators include feral dogs, feral cats, Indian jungle crows, shikras, black kites, black winged kites, and also barn owls. So coming to the methodology, we used direct observations, and observations were made from a distance using a pair of binoculars and a bridge camera. And nests were located based on the behavior of the parent bird, such as scraping the ground for nesting, incubating or threatening predators. So a total of 26 nests were found during the study period, and nests were monitored every 2 to 3 days until 25 days into incubation, or until noises from the chicks were observed, after which they were checked daily until hatching success data was obtained. And we used pollen sampling to assess the availability of food and vegetation cover at nest sites to understand how these factors affected the selection of nest sites by adult birds. And we utilized digital image analysis techniques and edge detection algorithms to quantitatively investigate how elevated lapwings employ different camouflage mechanisms to protect their eggs. And all these image analyses were run in MATLAB software. So the first step of the analysis involved dividing the image into three sections, the egg contour region, the outer region of the eggs, the egg internal region, the egg surface region, and the background substrate region. We then calculated variables related to the focused forms of camouflage, pattern complexity, and disruptive effects. So in terms of pattern complexity, animals exhibit enhanced camouflage when their resting or background substrate possesses more complex patterns than their own body patterns. This allows them to blend in effectively with their surroundings by utilizing the complexity of the environment or the background substrate. And whereas in disruptive effects, animals employ strategies to conceal their true outline with the help of the patterns present in the background substrate or their own body patterns, making it harder for predators to detect them. So by manipulating these elements, they can disrupt the perception of their distinct shape. And these are the variables related to the focused camouflage mechanisms. Complexity ratio is the ratio of edges detected in the egg surface region and the edges detected in the background substrate region. Disruptive ratio is the ratio of contour edges and the egg surface edges, and visibility ratio is the ratio of egg contour edges and the background substrate edges. And so in theory, a lower complexity ratio would result in better camouflage, because it would indicate that the edges of the background are more prominent compared to the edges of the egg surface. And when the disruptive ratio and visibility ratio are less than 1, the edges in the contour are harder to detect than those in the egg surface region or background substrate region, resulting in low detectability of the eggs. Conversely, when they are greater than 1, the edges in the contour are easier to detect than those in the eggs egg surface region or bag in substrate region, leading to high detectability of the eggs. So therefore, in simple terms, relatively, the lower the disruptive and visibility and complexity ratios, the better would be the camouflage. And this image here demonstrates the application of the edge detection algorithm. And if you look closely, you can actually see three eggs here, which is the same image as this, a little bit zoomed in. Now, coming to the results, let's first talk about the nest site choice. So as you can see in this graph, there is a negative correlation between insect density and the number of nests, and a positive correlation between vegetation cover and the number of nests. So as that is the preferred areas with low food availability and high vegetation for nesting. As expected, the allotted lapwings, like some other waders, preferred nest sites with higher vegetation cover that allows them to conceal their nest within the surrounding vegetation. And the presence of fewer nests in areas with high insect density points to potential competition for resources, including food and nesting sites, among the model species or other bird species. And then, when related nest site choice with the hatching success, we interestingly found a trend that we interestingly observed a trend that the nests with lower food availability in their surroundings had relatively higher hatching success rates, contradicting the common belief that high food availability leads to better breeding success in birds. So the areas with low food availability may experience reduced competition for resources and attract fewer potential predators or disturbances from other individuals or other bird species. This reduced disturbance could lower the risk of nest predation and in turn increase the likelihood of the hatching success, successful hatching. And the relation between hatching success and vegetation cover was inconclusive with a non-significant estimate. Coming to the camouflage and hatching success, as I mentioned earlier, the lower the complexity, disruptive and visibility ratios, the better would be the camouflage. But as you can see here, with the increase in complexity ratio, hatching success increased. This finding suggests that nests laid on background substrates with relatively fewer edges than egg surface edges experience higher hatching success rates, contrary to theoretical expectations where background substrates with more edges than egg surface edges are believed to achieve better camouflage. Our study demonstrated a different outcome. And with the decrease in disruptive ratio, hatching success increased. This is in line with the theory demonstrating lower disruptive ratios were linked to higher hatching success rates. And surprisingly, our findings on the visibility ratio also went against theoretical predictions. Although theory suggests that lower visibility ratio should lead to better camouflage and higher hatching success, our data showed the opposite. An increase in visibility ratio corresponded to increase in the probability of successful hatching. So although egg camouflage is an important defense mechanism against predators, in some cases it may not be sufficient and is likely to be the last line of defense against predations. In the case of allotted lapwings, visual concealment of nest through vegetation and the behavioral experience of nesting parents might have been the major contributing factor, contributing to the lack of perfect theoretical relation between camouflage and the hatching success rates. Now, the camouflage comparison between grass nests and the stone nests. So our analysis showed the grass nests had higher background edges compared to the stone nests, suggesting grass nests were constructed on substrates with higher edge complexity, indicating potentially better camouflage compared to stone nests based on this metric. And also the complexity ratio of grass nests were relatively lower compared to the stone nests, suggesting that grass nests are better camouflaged in terms of pattern complexity. And as you can see here, the disruptive ratio was lower in stone nest, and the visibility ratio was lower in grass nest. So in terms of disruptive ratio, stone nests were better camouflaged, and in terms of visibility ratio, grass nests were better camouflaged. Therefore, according to the variables of disruptive effects, both types exploited different strategies to achieve better camouflage. So to summarize this study, these are our main findings. The sampled population preferred to nest in areas with higher vegetation cover and lower food availability, and these nests experienced higher hatching success rates. And analyzed camouflage mechanisms did not contribute to the hatching success. And in terms of pattern complexity, grass nests were better camouflaged than stone nests, whereas according to the variables of disruptive effects, both types exploited different strategies to achieve better camouflage. So, and also, preference for stone or grass nests might be behavioral rather than genetic, as in terms of the number of surface egg edges and the egg contour edges, no significant difference was observed between the two nest types. These are a few selected references. My sincere thanks to my guides Roy and Geeta, and thank Veena for her assistance in the field, and Dr. Stoddard for providing the camouflage quantification code. I also appreciate the support from all the BioGSS lab members. And kindly scan this QR code if you are interested to know and read more about this project. And thank you for all attending my talk, and thanks to Animal Behavior Life for this opportunity.
Thank you, Vishwa. That was a fantastic talk. I think we are just waiting for questions to come from the YouTube chat in the meantime. Let me check. Yeah, we're still waiting. I think I had a few questions about the talk. The first one was, I was wondering, how do you normalize for the relative area that is being considered for the different contours? Because I guess the number of edges detected in a smaller area, like in the egg contour region, will be obviously lower than the number of edges, say, detected in the background or something, right? So do you normalize for it in some way?
It's basically the contour is exactly the, I mean, the outline of the egg. So it's not exactly, I mean,
I can't hear you clearly.
One second. Am I audible?
Yeah, it's a little better, but maybe not. So maybe you can reply, and then I can repeat the answer, or if that might be, yeah.
Okay, so you are asking about the contour edges, right? I mean, yeah. The outline edges. It's basically what we do is during this process, we just use freehand to outline the edges. So it's we can't exactly say we are taking too much area, we are taking too less area. So it's already a pre-established kind of procedure. So
okay. No, I was wondering more about because the ratio depends on obviously the number of edges you detect in any of these areas, right? And
yes,
that in turn will also depend on the actual area itself. Like if you have a larger area, you might end up having more edges. And so the ratio will be affected by this, by simply having larger area. Do you normalize for the area itself when you...
For the whole nest, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so for the whole nest, we kind of capture the images from 1 meter above the ground.
Okay.
That is one kind of, that is one thing. And one more thing is the whole diameter of the photo, we restricted it to 13 centimeters.
Okay.
So for all the nest, it was the same. I mean,
the
13
same.
Centimeters and 1 meter.
Okay. Nice. I guess I had maybe let me check. Yeah, so I had a slightly technical question. So the edge detection is purely based on thresholding, is it? Like intensity,
yes,
thresholding?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
There's nothing else, no other fanciness involved. It's just purely thresholding.
No,
yeah. Okay. And I guess I assume that the effectiveness of the camouflage depends on the visual system of maybe the predators of the species, right? Were you
Yes.
able to look at this in the study, or do you have some idea of what this is like?
This is usually when we look at the color mixture with the patterns. So the definition for the patterns, this patterns will be the same for all the predators, visual system, all the predator visual system. And we're also planning to do the color as well. We're planning to quantify the color, but it's a little complicated. We have to consider all the visual systems, I mean, all the predator visual systems, and then quantify it with the hatching factors. So it might take a little time.
Okay, so your feeling is that camouflage mostly depends on the pattern rather than the actual colors being, but there should be some effect of the color matching, right?
Yeah, that would be great, but at least in the case of lapwings, as you can see, I mean, other plovers as well, the eggs have all these markings on these eggs. So they should have some kind of importance,
Functions.
right?
Yes. Yeah. Right. Okay, I guess that is all the time we have for this talk. So I'll thank Vishwa, and if you have any more questions for him, he's available on the Discord, so you can just ask him and he'll be happy to answer. Thank you once again for joining us, and I'll let you leave the room now.
Yes, thank you.
So that with that, we come to the end of the first session of day one. A lot of interesting talks. Ants, bees, ants again, and finally birds, and the plenary on fig wasps, plants, ants, nematodes. We now have a short break before the break session, and we will be back soon in just about an hour with the third workshop, this time on animal DA. Hope you all have a good break and see you soon. And thank you to all the speakers who gave wonderful talks and made this session great. Thank you, and see you soon.